Good morning and welcome to the 21st meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2024. I've received apologies today from David Torrance. Our first item is to ask Joe Fitzpatrick to declare any interest relevant to the committee's remit. And I welcome Joe Fitzpatrick to the committee and to declare any relevant interest.
Thank you, Convener. Pleased to be on the committee and I have no relevant interests to declare. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Fitzpatrick. The second item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4, 5 and 6 in private. Are members agreed? Yes. Thank you. The next item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport. This session will conclude the committee's oral evidence gathering as part of phase two of our post-legislative scrutiny of the Social Care Self-Directed Support Scotland Act 2013. And I welcome to the committee Marie Todd, Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport, Joanne Finlay, Policy Lead, Self-Directed Support Improvement Team, and Rachel Magruder, Deputy Director of Adult Social Care, Local Improvement and Transformation Division, all from Scottish Government. And I invite the Minister to give a brief opening statement.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to start by thanking the committee and all those who've taken time to give evidence over the course of the last few months. I very much welcome any chance to shine a light on self-directed support, a policy in which Scotland is leading the rest of the world. The SDS journey began in the passing of the 2013 Act, which signified a fundamental shift in mindsets, recognising that individuals are the experts in their own lives and should be fully supported to make their own decisions about their care and support. Since then, we've witnessed the tangible impact the introduction of SDS has had on the lives of countless individuals across Scotland. Through personalised budgets and tailored support plans, people have been able to live more independently, pursue their passions and participate in their communities in a way that just wasn't possible previously. I've seen myself the impact that SDS makes to individuals, including at a recent visit to the Lothian Centre for Inclusive Living. And whilst I'm aware that the committee have heard of many examples where SDS is being implemented in accordance with the 2013 Act, I'm aware and have also heard that there is still work to be done across a number of areas, including to ensure consistency of implementation across local authorities and in the provision of information and access to advocacy, addressing the wider workforce issues, including recruitment, retention and training of staff, clarifying how SDS will work in the context of the proposed National Care Service. As members will be aware, the Scottish Government and COSLA's jointly published Self-Directed Support Improvement Plan sets out how we're continuing to drive forward in improvements in SDS. The plan recognises the need for a whole system approach. Whilst the Scottish Government can set the legislative framework and can foster connections to promote collaborative working in the areas most needed, it is vital that delivery partners across statutory, third and independent sectors all play a role in implementation. This includes local authorities and integration authorities who have a statutory responsibility to ensure that people are able to get the support that is right for them. The plan is supported by updated guidance and a framework of standards which make clear the expectations of local authorities in the provision of care and support. However, let me be clear, it is not right that an individual in one locality has limited options available to them in comparison to their counterparts in another part of the country. This inconsistency in the access to SDS is an example of why the Scottish Government have introduced the National Care Service Scotland Bill. It'll allow Scottish ministers greater oversight over the quality and a greater ability to drive consistency of social care in Scotland to reduce the inequality that we all know exists in the system. Through the NCS National Board, there will also be the opportunity to further share good practice across the country to enable it to become more widespread. With the NCS will also come greater financial clarity and transparency, something that becomes more and more important as financial pressures continue to build. The SDS Act was a significant step, but there are still many challenges facing us, and I recognise the need for further improvement in the delivery of SDS at a local level. The Scottish Government remains committed to driving forward improvements in the way in which social care is delivered. That commitment extends to embedding the principles of SDS within the National Care Service. Thank you.
And I'm aware that we have limited time with you, so if I can ask members to be concise with their questions, and if the Minister and our officials can be concise with their answers, that would help us get through all the committee's questions. And move first to Carol Mokin.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Thank you for the introduction. I think it set out some of the things that we have heard in evidence around that approach and the difference that people get. My particular question is around the start of the journey when people are provided with information, you know, and advice and support on self-directed support. And I'm interested in that notion nationally, what we can do to try and get that consistency. And I wondered whether the Minister has anything in place at the moment. You talked about, you know, the new National Care Service, but at the moment, what could we do, what could the government do to try and help with that initial stage on information and the choice around that?
The government encourages all local authorities to approach SDS in the same way so that people understand their options and are offered the full range of choices through SDS. And I'm aware that there is an inconsistency of support available across the country. In April, the Scottish Government introduced the Support in the Right Direction, well, relaunched the Support in the Right Direction programme, and has committed £9.2 million to fund the programme for the next 3 years. And I have to say I was absolutely, personally delighted to see that multi-year funding for this programme, because it's very important that it is embedded and continues. That will ensure that people who are requiring social care support across Scotland will have access to independent support, information, advice and advocacy in line with the Scottish Government vision for self-directed support. Inspiring Scotland's the fund manager for SIRD programme, which is delivered through partnership arrangements with third sector organisations and local authorities right across Scotland. And there are 33 organisations across the country funded by Scottish Government through the SIRD programme, which covers all 32 local authority areas. So that's one really significant piece of work that is being done in order to ensure that people have the right information, options and support in order to make the right decisions.
Thank you for that, Minister. Can I ask about the sort of statutory responsibility, including our social workers who are under enormous pressure? I'm sure you would accept that. How we support the statutory services, particularly with social workers, to get that information as people come in to start their journey in social care?
So we have a number of pieces of work in place to support the social work profession, both to ensure that there is a standard level of knowledge across the profession for all social workers. But also we are beginning a programme of support for newly qualified social workers and for social workers who choose to specialise and continue to gain qualifications throughout their career. So we're trying to standardise that approach. You'd be aware that there are 32 different employers for social workers across Scotland, 32 different sets of paying conditions, 32 different local authorities doing workforce planning for social work. And we see the National Care Service as a real opportunity to bring some cohesion to that picture. So the National Social Work Agency, which has planned, will sit on the National Care Service board and will bring some national standards and national planning to those particular challenges for that profession. I don't know if either of my colleagues wish to add anything more particularly about the social work profession, but I do see the National Care Service as a real opportunity for social workers. Social workers, as you rightly say, are crucial to the good functioning or the high quality functioning of a social care system, and supporting that profession and ensuring that they flourish and thrive and are able to do the job that they came in to do is a really important part of how we intend to improve the quality of social care in future.
That's...
So I was just going to add that I was we obviously give out the local authority transformational funding each year, which is £3.696 million, and I had just received back all of the reports from the local authorities, and one of the things that we did ask about obviously is particularly about restaffing, and you know, and looking through that, I looked at some of quite a few of them had mentioned using some of that funding to help train some of their new social workers that were coming in, because obviously they noticed that there was a bit of a gap in their training coming from university, and I think that's been identified, you know, within the committee, and I know that that's something that's been addressed and acknowledged with the development of the national social work agency and some of the work that they're doing currently. So that is quite good that we can see that some of that funding is being used to that actually, you know, through the statutory sector.
And I was just going to add as well, I think in terms of the activity we're carrying out now, I know that Social Work Scotland have come to the committee already and given some evidence about the work they've been doing in this space. So have been funding them to update the self-directed support framework of standards, which has just recently been updated and issued. And that was developed by a range of stakeholders across the country, but also to make sure that there's as much clarity as possible to the social workforce. There's also been the development for practitioners toolkit, which we funded to be led by Social Work Scotland. And once again, that's been developed in collaboration with stakeholders across the country. And that's to, in line with what Joanne said, is to kind of support local authorities in knowing best practice and implementing self-directed support within their local areas.
Thank you. I've got one small, if I may, convener. I'm just interested to know a little bit about funding about those independent advocacy services. And I'm wondering if we have secure funding after 2027.
I haven't, but I think that three-year commitment in the landscape that we are in kind of shows the intent of government. So we see this as something that's absolutely crucial. We know that the third sector are playing a really important role in this, and we know how important it is for them to have secure funding. So I'm delighted to have the 3 years funding secure, and I think that that demonstrates the ongoing commitment to that particular aspect of self-directed support.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Thank you. Gillian McKay.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. Self-directed support has understandably been implemented alongside other pressing issues, which some believe has affected its prioritisation. In your opinion, how can we better manage and align the implementation of SDS with other legislative and policy demands to ensure it receives the necessary focus and resources?
I mean, that's a really good question. So I think this committee will be well aware of the complexity of the health and social care system and how challenging it is to have an impact from the centre. I think that one of the reasons I am so committed to the National Care Service is that I recognise that we absolutely need to have that government direction and responsibility, but we need to work with local systems as well. It cannot be one or the other, it has to be both. And that tripartite agreement in accountability that we struck with the National Care Service moving forward will help us to bring some cohesion to this complex landscape that we're all operating in. The other challenge that we have in health and social care systems as a whole is that we can't afford to get it wrong, because people's lives depend on it. People are absolutely, these are essential services, so we really need to manage change very carefully, and we are well aware of that responsibility, and we are managing change carefully. One of the things with the self-directed support, I suppose, rather than the operational directions and guidelines on how to do it, is really the ethos of it, and that was a huge shift in culture. So a shift to where the person is at the centre of the decision, their human rights are being upheld, early intervention and prevention and support being wrapped around that individual to make decisions that suit them and help them to achieve their life goals. And I think you'll see that ethos firmly embedded in everything that we do from now on. We know it's absolutely the right thing to do. It is challenging. And this sort of post-legislative scrutiny of this particular piece of legislation is really welcome. We are keen to keep going back and looking again and seeing how we can improve it. Again, I would say, and you would expect me to say this, as somebody who is steering the National Care Service Bill through Parliament, I see an opportunity through the National Care Service Bill to pick up on areas of good practice, as well as to bring grip and coherence and assurance to areas where practice is falling down. But I see an opportunity to pick up on areas of good practice and to quickly translate them across the country. And I think that really excites me, because that has been challenging in the past as well.
You mentioned the sort of different layers of delivery in there, and where policy can be quite inspirational and very forward-looking and things. By the time you get through all the layers and there's a little bit of a change in interpretation and a change in interpretation, it's suddenly away from what that initial policy set out to do. And I think that's certainly through some of that local variation, that's probably what we're hearing from people. How do we sort of pull that back in to alignment? How do we make sure that actually the initial ethos of that self-directed support being the primary delivery model, which I don't still think is well understood that it is, for social care, how do we make sure that that does actually align neatly all the way down the structure, rather than what we're seeing at the moment of that interpretation knocking it out of line in different places?
So I would agree with you that it is the primary delivery mechanism, and that isn't always recognised. I meet constituents on a regular basis, as all of you will, who say, oh, I've been put onto this SDS, and they don't realise that that is the way that we deliver social care. So they think that option one, for example, is the only option of SDS. I think probably as well as the geographical variation, which reflects culture and delegation practices and the levels of integration in each local area, we also are operating in a system where there are different pressures coming from, you know, external pressures coming from other places. So the pandemic has undoubtedly been a huge pressure to our systems, and the financial situation that we find ourselves in now, the post-Brexit challenges with immigration and some of the labour shortages that we have across the country are another pressure. So even within the geographical area that I represent, I have seen real changes. So when I first was elected as a representative, I met with local representatives in the Highlands who just blew me away with their description of this amazing opportunity that they had to live their lives to the full and to avoid being institutionalised in any way. Young people who were using their SDS support to follow their dreams, and it just was magical to hear about. Now I would say more commonly, and this is probably in common with every representative around this table, I hear concerns that where there is market failure, so where the local authority has struggled to provide care, people are being told, oh, don't worry, you can have this budget and you can find care for yourself. And that is not the intention. People are meant to be able to choose the option that works for them. And it is not meant to be, you know, option one is the final stop when market failure has occurred. So these are challenges that we're well aware of. And I suppose the way to avoid those being challenges for people who are trying to access care is to focus our work on improving workforce planning, ensuring that we have sufficient funding going into the system. And again, we have a lot of work going on across the piece to do that. We committed to increasing the funding of social care by a quarter this term of Parliament. We've delivered that 2 years ahead of schedule. But we're often not feeling that at the coalface. So I go back to, again, we need the National Care Service to provide some grip and assurance on following the money, making sure the money is getting where we need it to be. And the workforce issues are undoubtedly really challenging. We will improve those by tackling not just pay, which is really important, but also social care conditions, also the level of support that's given to social care staff so that they feel well supported and can flourish in their professional and vital role. And we have work going on right across the piece to try to do that. It is not as simple as flicking a switch, though, and it is exceptionally costly, so has to be done carefully. But I would like to go further and faster, but I think we're on a path, and we can see that, you know, that each social care worker in Scotland is paid £2,000 more than last year. Their wages are going up substantially each year. Social care workers in Scotland are paid more than their counterparts in the rest of the UK and pay less tax than their counterparts in the rest of the UK. We're on a pathway. We're not where we want to be, but we're definitely, we have, this government has set out its stall and is making improvements incrementally in social care that will help us to solve those big picture problems.
That's great. Thanks, Convener.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. Good morning to you all. Just as a wee supplementary question, you've covered it a wee bit already with the Carol Mawkins questions, but the we took evidence that said that it was from Dumfries and Galloway that self-directed support policies hadn't been reviewed since the IGB was set up in Dumfries and Galloway. And Stephen Morgan, the chief social worker who came and gave us evidence, he also described that the results of a recent audit contravened the principles of the SDS Act. So it's just what work is the Scottish Government doing to support COSLA, or to work with COSLA to support the review of self-directed support in terms of integration joint boards, health social care partnerships?
So it is really challenging to achieve that consistency across the board. And we work not just with COSLA, but directly with chief officers in each local authority area. We have updated the statutory guidance a couple of years ago to make it clearer on how we expect the policy to be implemented, to try to tackle that risk-averse approach that we see in some parts of the country and those organisational or cultural barriers that might undermine that flexibility, autonomy and choice which are at the core of SDS. We've also funded Social Work Scotland, and I'll let my colleagues say a little, and you're probably best to come in on this, funded Social Work Scotland to update the SDS framework of standards and to create that practitioner's toolkit. Both of those things will help us to improve consistency across the country. Although I think this is absolutely a strong case for why we need a national care service. Again, you would expect me to say that, but I think that where there isn't consistency and where it is challenging for local areas, that ability to have national oversight and national support frameworks, I think it's really important to ensure that each area can learn from each other. At the moment, they're working in isolation, and we really need to improve on the learning across the country, I think.
Yeah, so through the improvement plan, as you said, with the framework, there was a number of local authorities that were working with Social Work Scotland on the development of that, and there's been a number of reflections and research published on the Care Inspectorate website that has the SDS library on there. We've also, through the improvement team, offered out via the SDS practitioners network to work with local authorities on improvements before. I know that my colleague that I work with was involved with that last year, so that has been an offer from the improvement team. So that's something that we can take forward.
Okay, thanks.
Ruth Maguire.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and your officials. You mentioned, Minister, the budget for social care support and NCS delivery has increased, I think 29.1% this year. I think that committee, and I'm sure Scottish Government would acknowledge the pressures on social care budgets, both in terms of, as you mentioned, recruitment and retention of staff, and also those cost pressures around commissioning. Committee has heard calls that investment of money and energy would be best placed in tackling those kind of frontline pressures and the pressures to core service. I wonder, to what extent do you feel the
use of eligibility criteria and the four SDS options remain useful to us in understanding how social care operates in Scotland, and probably more importantly, ensuring that it's delivered equitably.
So I think, firstly, in terms of the current pressures that we are facing, I think that everybody would acknowledge just how challenging the landscape is at the moment. There were some pressures which were building, and this has been a long review, actually, of SDS. So there were pressures that were building before the pandemic. We have an ageing demographic, which is, it's a great thing that people are living longer, but they're living longer with more complex ill health and requiring more social care support. People are living independently with conditions that they wouldn't have been able to in the past. So there are some pressures built in. There's been 14 years of austerity, which has, I think everyone would acknowledge, challenged all of our local services. All of our public services are feeling stretched to the limit. Any changes that can be made to improve efficiency have been made, and we're at the point now where any further savings have an impact on delivery, and I think that's across the board. People are feeling like that. And then we've got, the pandemic has caused a real challenge, and, just this morning, pre-cabinet, we have a meeting every week as a health portfolio team, and we were discussing again some of the challenges that we face in terms of who presents at what stage of illness. People are presenting further on in their illnesses, people are presenting more acutely unwell, there is more complexity still than there was pre-pandemic, and there's also more COVID. At the moment we have an increase in the level of COVID in our community. All of these things are still exerting pressure on our health and social care system. So it is undoubtedly an exceptionally challenging time at the moment. So in order to rise and meet those challenges and pressures that we face at the moment, we are having weekly CRAG meetings, so weekly meetings of the whole system, in order to assess what is happening in health and social care in Scotland, what can be done to improve the situation. A recognition that our level of delayed discharges, for example, and you'll have heard the First Minister's real focus on delayed discharges, that used to be a seasonally variable figure. It would go down in summer and up in winter. The pressure of delayed discharges has been relentless and year-round for a number of years since we entered the pandemic. So we have a real focus over the course of the next few months on trying to improve that situation in order that we have some headroom. And you'll have seen from the letter I sent this committee yesterday about the National Care Service, we've taken a pause on our discussions on one or two amendments that are still not agreed by myself and COSLA, in order to free up the space to focus on that acute system pressures over the course of the next few months, rather than the systemic solutions that might be a little further down the line. I don't know if my colleagues want to say a little bit more about eligibility and options in future.
So eligibility criteria, we heard from the Feely review, obviously, that there were challenges to eligibility criteria and how it was seen sometimes as a barrier to access of self-directed support and that choice that people were considered. So we are working with COSLA under a joint statement of intent to review that eligibility criteria as part of the National Care Service programme of reforms. I think this also speaks to some of the points that the committee have previously heard regarding data on self-directed support as well, and our attempts ahead of the National Care Service to improve the data and the information we have about access to self-directed support across the country. And my colleague Joanne might be able to provide a bit more information about some of the work we've recently done in the Health and Care Experience Survey, which is telling us more about how we are truly meeting those SDS principles of choice and a person-centred approach, because we recognise that it is, as the Minister said, a world-leading policy and we agree with all those principles of a person-centred approach, and it supports early intervention. We know that is the best way to deliver social care within the system, and we need to make sure that we're gathering the information so we know that is being consistently applied across the country. So I don't know if you want to come in, Joanne.
Yeah, so we, as a policy team, we've been working with the Health Experience Survey data, and we managed to very much, prior to this year, it was across the board just for social care data. But if we add five questions into the report, just to try to find a little bit more information about, you know, whether people were being offered their choice and they got the preference of the choice, and if they didn't get that, and if they were not offered any choice, did they not want any choice, and did they not know whether they were getting the choice? But basically, we're trying to work out with that a little bit more about how people were experiencing SDS, and if they were being offered different options within SDS. And that data was just published last month, and we can start to use that as sort of baseline to see over the next few years how that's changing.
I think it's always challenging as a constituency MSP, because obviously you have first-hand experience of where needs are not being met. So some of these abstract discussions don't always resonate. And I suppose that world-leading policy is only of any use if that's how our citizens are experiencing it. Now, that said, I think that sometimes, I mean, we spoke, Minister, about the duties of delivery partners, and I guess that, you know, there are risks involved in being over-prescriptive in legislation. Would you talk to some of those? I guess in terms of, you know, things like if we define eligibility criteria or define options for how social care is arranged, there's risk there,
yeah,
isn't there?
Absolutely so. As I always say when answering questions of this nature, I'm a Highland MSP, and I am somebody who knows at my core that one size does not fit all. And in fact, where I live in the Highlands, in a rural West Highland village, social care is delivered in a very different way to even Inverness, just along the road within the same local authority area, within the same integration authority. So it is challenging to be prescriptive. I don't think, though, that should prevent us from recognising that this... I mean, I think time and time again, when we've looked at the health and social care system, we recognise that the level of variation is too great, and that it isn't really explainable for good reasons. So you can see real significant, and I suppose we talk about good variation and bad variation, so necessary variation and unnecessary variation. And we want to look at, we're not interested in ironing out, you know, variation that has to occur because you live in a remote West Highland village and there are limited assets available to you. Yes, in that situation, we really want flexibility, and we want those, you know, those individuals who, mostly in my part of the world, I meet people who are desperately keen to stay in their own communities and happy to tolerate some variation in how care is delivered in order to enable that core aim. The unnecessary variation, which comes from culture and systems and risk aversion particularly, are the things that we need to iron out. And we need to give people the confidence to operate the system properly and to properly put the person at the very centre of the decision making and in the lead. Then I think we'll be able to... It won't look exactly the same in every part of the country, but it will be... It will reach those standards of quality that we are aiming for with this piece of legislation.
OK, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister. A stakeholder in the social care sector shared with me that STS has, and she quote, to quote, not been the opportunity so far that has fulfilled its promise, and you've alluded to that this morning. She said that social care is rationed heavily, a new case can only be funded when one person no longer needs it and the number needing support is growing. So I recognise that today you have said that you acknowledge that, but do you accept that in principle the resources are not in place, and why not put it right now, get accurate data before overlaying additional complexity?
So we are working on accurate data. And it is not as simple as saying, it, you know, let's put in extra money. If it were that simple, we probably would just throw money at it. But there's a recognition. I think most people would recognise that actually a change in approach is required as well as extra money, that there are challenges in following the money across the system, so there are challenges in seeing where the money goes within social care. It's quite complex to follow it. There's a general acknowledgement that we are not getting in early enough, so we focus very much, and if we go back to data, one of the problems with data is we focus very much on the things that are easy to count. So we focus very closely on delayed discharges, what we call the back door of the hospital. It is less straightforward to measure unmet need in the community. And actually, if we could get that fixed, that would help us with early intervention and prevention and mean that money was spent more efficiently. Some of the calculations around early intervention and prevention, there's a suggestion that you could probably help twice as many people if you were able to get in earlier, rather than waiting till somebody reaches crisis, is admitted to hospital, and a frail elderly person being discharged from hospital is likely to need twice the package of care than they would have needed if we'd got them earlier, sooner. So it really isn't, if it were, you know, this is not an easy thing to do, but morally and ethically and economically, we have to get in earlier, higher upstream, and we have to have more grip and assurance across our system. We have to understand what is going on and make sure that not just that money goes into the system, but the money going into the system goes to the right place. And I think that there is general agreement. Very few people have concerns about the National Care Service. They have concerns about the government's delivery of social care, but very few people argue for the status quo as things stand and just more money to do things the way that we do things now.
Thank you, Miss. I'm not suggesting more money. I'm actually suggesting focus on getting the data and taking action rather than adding additional complexity with a new system. My second question is around option one, which you did refer to, and that certain people just think that there is only one option one. But in one part of Scotland, it's being used as the only option. So options two, three and four are not being offered, and there's insufficient resource locally to create a support package. In another part of Scotland with option one, a social worker came up with a package in line with the guidelines that was acceptable to the individual, which then had to be withdrawn because it couldn't be funded. And this is a direct quote from a parent with a child with autism, and she said, SDS is the SNP's cornerstone strategy for delivering social care, but it is not being applied as directed, and parents are left hanging. So what will the Scottish Government give to local authorities? What resources will they give to make sure they actually can successfully implement all four of the SDS options? Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, I certainly in my casework as a constituency MSP hear that concern around people think that option one is SDS, and that concerns me because that suggests that people trying to access social care at the coalface are not being talked through the whole suite of options available to them, and that option one is being used as the default setting. And I think that is a real challenge that we would recognise. So we're working very closely, as Rachel said earlier, with NCS colleagues to try to ensure that the principles of SDS are embedded within the creation of the NCS bill, and to make sure that the SDS improvement plan, which we are working through at the moment, is completed and then embedded into the National Care Service, so that it will those improvements in practice and that genuine offer of flexible choice is available to everyone across the country, and that change in practice is embedded in future social care delivery across the country. I don't know if you want to say a little bit.
more about that?
We are funding In Control, part of what you're saying as the SDS Improvement Plan, and part of their work has been working with local authorities on Option 2 and Option 3 delivery, and looking at the barriers and the challenges to delivering and offering different options. They're working on a contract for providers with Option 2. So there is work in the system, and I say we're working in Control have done a lot of work last year and continuing with that work, and they've engaged with a number of local authorities with that.
Thank you. How can you actually do that if the data that's coming forwards to Public Health Scotland isn't there? So you can't improve it if some of the local authorities are not providing the data. And we've struggled with the data. We had a whole session last week on the data. The data isn't there. It's not being provided. So how can you actually give the local authorities the resources to implement 2, 3 and 4 if you don't know what options are being delivered, where they're being delivered, why they're not being delivered? I suppose that's what I'm struggling with.
I agree with what you're saying with the Public Health Scotland data, and that's actually why the collection of the data is being suspended at the moment, and they are working through. We've had conversations with them about how we can collect better data, because we're aware that there has been some challenges with the data and the recording of all the four different options coming, the data coming from local authorities. So that is something we've had, we've got in training. We have had conversations with Public Health Scotland, and that's why it's paused at the moment. So we're trying to look at how we can actually improve that data.
But you can't manage what you can't measure, and if you haven't got the data, you can't measure it. So how can you improve it if you haven't got the data?
So that's why we have a programme in place to try to improve the data. So we are working with Public Health Scotland to try to improve the quality of data. I agree with you, it's very difficult if we don't have high quality data. So we're working with Public Health Scotland. They've suspended their collection of data at the moment. We will come back with a better collection of data in order to enable us to manage more appropriately and more effectively the whole system using that high-quality data. We have also, as Joanne mentioned earlier, looked at the Health and Care Experience Survey. Now, that's a different methodology. It's always difficult to introduce different ways of collecting information, but we look at a whole variety of data sources. Some of them well scrutinised and of high quality, some of them more anecdotal and, you know, less what you would call management information. So we can't publish them because it's not sufficiently high quality, but we are looking at data and we are determined to find ways to measure the right things without putting a burden onto a system that's already overburdened, exactly as you say, in order to enable us to have that grip and assurance. Not just me, the local system, to have grip and assurance in order to ensure that delivery improves.
I think people just want the resources to get it in place. Can I go on to the next?
Only if you are extremely...
I'll be very quick.
15 minutes left and there's still lots of questions.
I'll just be one on the next section, which is national consistency. So, Joanne Finley, you talked about the 3.69 million. Will the additional funding in social care budget be ring-fenced so that it directly supports activities that improve capacity and the ability of local authorities to offer the good outcomes that have been promised? Thank you.
Okay. So the money that goes to the local authority, the local transformational funding, part of that money is specifically for a particular one post per local authority. And the reporting that we get back from the local authorities, we got back just at the end of last month, indicates what posts they have used the money for. So we are getting direct reporting on that particular piece of funding. And it, as I say, there is an SDS practitioners network meeting that I attend, where all the SDS leads attend, and part of that funding is to for the post per local authority for the SDS.
Supplementary from Paul Swan.
Thank you, convener. Thanks to the panel so far. certainly flaws in data collection, certainly the qualitative aspects of data collection has been highlighted by previous witnesses to the panel, and that is well understood. What was also highlighted was concerns about the interface with the public bodies Joint Working Scotland Act of 2014, how that has created a culture of competition for resources and other resources or other areas of public social care provision are superseding the principles of SDS. Is this something that you will be seeking to further investigate? Because it's certainly a concern that has been raised by a number of witnesses that the principles haven't been well embedded in that 2014 Act and are creating a culture which is militating against its effects.
So we're keen to identify any barriers to implementation of full integration, I would say, across the board. So any barriers that this post-legislative scrutiny identifies, we will be looking at to try to improve and to take action to ensure that the system operates as intended. I don't know, Rachel, if you want to say a little bit more about the evidence that's been gathered so far in this.
So I suppose this also speaks to the points the committee have heard regarding the reflection of SDS principles within the National Care Service Bill as well. And we would believe that we're on a principle of continuous improvement, where we've had the SDS Act 2013 and then the Public Bodies Act of 2014, and then the NCS goes to strengthen integration and strengthen that person-centred approach. We believe that's all part of a flight path of continuous improvement. The principles of the SDS are reflected within the NCS legislation and the NCS principles at the beginning of that bill. Those align with each other. We don't believe that they are in conflict with each other, but actually they strengthen that person-centred early intervention, the support of independent living, all those core principles of the SDS, we believe, are continue to be reflected in the legislation and are further reinforced through the NCS bill.
Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. I am conscious of the time. I'm just interested in issues around education and social worker training, but even wider, like health professionals like nurses and their knowledge of self-directed support, not that they need to know it in like absolute detail, but just a trigger for potential referral, for instance, when they're coming across patients in acute care or in the community. But I'm also interested in how do we help the higher learning institutions convey self-directed support information within the curriculum so that social workers are aware of what self-directed support is all about, even if it's the principles and issues, so that they can trigger then assessments by dietitians, physios, OTs, for instance. So I'm not suggesting that social workers need to be experts in it or even nurses, but have some kind of knowledge in what self-directed support means.
So I think you're right. I think everybody working in social care, in the health and social care system as a whole, needs to have that understanding of how social care in Scotland works. And we are working, I mean, at the moment, one of the aims of our current work to tackle the acute issues that the system faces, as Ruth Maguire was alluding to, is working with healthcare systems to try to ensure that there is early referral, so early discharge planning, for example, and that requires you to have an understanding of what's available in the community and who needs to be involved in the process of putting together a package of care post-discharge. So there needs to be a level of working knowledge in the healthcare system as well as in the social care system in order to ensure that things are operating efficiently and effectively right across the board. There are certain professions that are crucial, though. So social care, social workers are absolutely crucial to the high functioning of this system. And I am more and more convinced of this every day. So from my perspective, as a general rule, it's really important that we support that profession, that we ensure that they are supported to make the professional and statutory underpinned decisions that they are meant to be making to support individuals' human rights as they access social care. And I think that we can do that both by tackling undergraduate support and training, but also postgraduate support and training. So that work that we spoke about earlier about supporting and mentoring newly qualified social workers, and also ensuring that there is a pathway in place for social workers who want to pursue higher qualifications in postgraduate, I think all of that is really important, that reflects not just the practical operation of the SDS, but the culture and ethos of SDS, which is about flexibility, choice, upholding independence. I joke with the SDS audience, I'm all about the independence. And I absolutely get it, how important their autonomy, an individual's autonomy to make the decisions to have social care that supports them, for example, to work or, whatever it is they want to do. Really, really crucial. And a postgraduate opportunity, or for people working in the system, we have a real opportunity through both NESS and SSSC registration to get training packages that work in a multidisciplinary way right across the system, which will, I think, be really helpful in tackling some of the barriers. So if I think, for example, one of the communities who really struggle to have their rights upheld are people with learning disabilities, and there's really good opportunities to train everyone working in the system with how to engage with people with learning disabilities offered by NESS, multidisciplinary postgraduate or post-qualification training, post-registration training available for everyone who might come across these people, to help them, to engage them fully in the process of decision making so that they can make a good informed decision that suits them and that fulfills their rights, upholds their rights and fulfills their dreams and ambitions for their lives.
Just to pick up on the multidisciplinary team aspects, I've heard directly from my own casework that social workers are absolutely key and crucial to helping get people to the services that they need. And one of our social work teams is an MDT model, but there's others that are not. They're just like the social workers working independently alone with no direct pick up the phone, call somebody to refer to physio or whatever. The standards for social work education in Scotland actually do cover information about social workers being innovative and empowered as well. And in the final page of the social work education, it talks about ethical principles, and it talks about what matters to the person, and it talks about that it promotes the full involvement and participation of people receiving the services, and goes on to talk about what matters to them. So that is, in essence, choice and control. So obviously social workers are critical. We need to value their job. It's absolutely crucial to how they do it. So do you have any opinion about how we make or we improve connectivity with using a multidisciplinary team approach, which seems to be valued by many that are find it very positive in that aspect of that type of model?
So I agree with you. There is a lot of variation in how teams are set up around the country, and that does present one of the challenges for people. And certainly there are situations that we're coming across at the moment as we try to drill down and understand what's happening, what's leading to the acute pressures that we're feeling at the moment, where we are finding that social work haven't been involved, even though they have capacity. So there are definitely barriers in the way that teams are set up locally that are making things difficult. One of the really exciting pieces of work that we're doing from government is looking at GERFI. You'll be aware of GERFEC, so getting it right for every child. This is an approach for adults looking with complex needs, looking at getting it right for everyone. And that really is a proper multidisciplinary approach to some of these more complex cases, making sure that it's not just multidisciplinary, it's multi-agency, recognising that some people require everyone to coalesce around them and provide that package of care so they can't fall through the net, and ensuring that we find ways to deliver that care to people with complex needs that go right up. You know, our services operate in siloed ways, but human beings don't. So we're always trying to crack that particular thing. And GURFI, I think there's a few GURFI pathfinders operating across the country at the moment. That will give us an understanding of how we can provide a more personalised way to access help and support when it's needed, putting the person at the centre of all the decisions that affect them to achieve the best outcomes. If you think about overlap with GURFI, you know, putting the team around the child, putting the team around the person, and making sure that all of these public services, instead of, you know, I've talked before about some individuals I meet being like a pinball, pinging back and forth through different systems and struggling to have their rights upheld and their needs met. We think this approach of ensuring that the person is at the centre and the team is around them working together to ensure that their needs are met and that their rights are upheld will help. So we're working very carefully on that at the moment, and I think that will really help with those complex cases where there are not just multiple disciplines but often multiple agencies involved.
Okay, thank you. Thanks.
Sandra Skohani.
Thank you, Convener. Declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. And good morning, Minister. Given we are the sport committee, I thought I'd take this opportunity to congratulate my local club, Glasgow Warriors, on their URC triumph. The average working life of a social worker is 6 years, and we have seen a shortage of social workers who are struggling to cope with their current demands and workloads. And government bills coming through Parliament will require social workers to deliver them, like the Children's Justice Bill, which will require some 500 social workers. So how can we deliver social workers to not only do what they're doing now, but the things the government want them to do in the future?
So first of all, as a Warriors fan myself, as I say regularly to folk, I'm Glasgow by marriage. So I'm a huge Warriors fan. I was absolutely delighted in a tough weekend of sport for Scotland. Their win in Pretoria was absolutely uplifting for the whole nation, and we're very proud of what they've achieved. Inspirational to many. So in terms of the social work profession, I would absolutely recognise that there is a challenge in there for government to ensure. I mean, I suppose if I put it very simply, I see, and you will have worked, being a clinician, I'm a clinician too. I worked as a mental health pharmacist for 20 years in a multidisciplinary team. Social workers were a key component of that team. Social workers, in my experience, are social justice warriors. They come in to uphold the human rights of the people that they work with. And what has happened over the course of a number of years is that the system has forced them to focus on issues like budgets and issues like eligibility, rather than on the individual at the centre of their care that's requiring care and requiring their needs met and their rights upheld. So I see it as a responsibility of government to ensure that social workers can go back to the job that they came in to do. I think that one of the reasons that so many social workers are leaving the profession is because they are disappointed with the reality of the job once they get qualified. And as I've said before, a number of things. So we need better workforce planning across the country. We need better numbers being produced, better numbers being trained. We need better liaison between local authorities and universities in order to ensure that there are training placements for undergraduates and postgraduates in order that they can be supported to become the professionals that we need them to be. We need a strong postgraduate process of further education. So, you know, as any professional, and there's a number of health professionals around this table, we recognise that you don't come out of university ready to be the professional that you need to be. There's a period of further training once you're qualified. So we want that post degree support and mentorship and training to be in place and solidified and nationally led. The National Social Work Agency will provide us with an opportunity to put in
core standards that every social worker will be expected to work to. And whilst, as you allude in your question, that might be felt as some by some social workers as a pressure, a further thing that we are asking them to do, many social workers tell me that that will give them the ability and the freedom to focus on the things that are important, like upholding human rights of individuals, because they will be expected to work to a national standard rather than follow the local pressure of ensuring the budget is delivered. So I think there is a huge amount that we can do to support the profession of social worker. Social workers, I would reiterate again how crucial they are. You know, when I go around the country, when I see systems that work really well, usually the social work profession has a high profile and is well supported to do the job that they need to do in those areas where things are working well. So I think, I don't know, it's anecdotal, I think the evidence is clear. If we support that profession, the quality will be uplifted throughout the country, and it's a really important piece of work. The responsibility for the social work profession lies with Angela Constance. She herself is a social worker, so has a passion for that. Natalie Dawn also shares some responsibility as the Minister for Children and Young People. So the three of us work regularly with the Office of the Chief Social Worker, Iona Colvin and her team, to try to ensure that we are delivering a social work workforce that are fit for the future, that are supported to be the autonomous professionals empowered to deliver within the system. And I think that will deliver for Scotland.
Thank you.
Minister, I'm conscious that we've actually got to the end of our time. I wonder if you'd be willing to stay with us for a slightly longer period, till about 25 past, and hopefully by that point the committee will have got through all of our questions. Can I ask and pick up on some of what you said in your opening statement when you were talking about SDS assisting people to pursue their passions and their interests and enhance their quality of life? And witnesses have suggested to the committee that there's a tension between their accounting rules and how they commission and procure services more flexibly. And we heard some examples of that. So can you tell me what Scottish Government's doing to examine any barriers there are to better commissioning and procurement processes, which might not be in terms of absolutely direct care, but is in the wider sense of enhancing people's lives and allowing them to be more independent?
Yeah, I'm going to ask Joanne to come in first on this. I mean, I think that need for flexibility. So we are doing work all around the country to try to ensure that SDS is delivered as flexibly as possible. At the moment, we have a request in from Highland to clarify some of the flexibilities that they might need in very remote communities where everybody is related, frankly. This is a challenge I have in my constituency. So in ensuring that there are tight controls and the possibility for exploitation of vulnerable people, but also that there is a recognition that having family support you in a very remote and rural community might well be the only option that you can have. And we're working with them on ensuring that we can deliver those flexibilities, safeguarding individuals' human rights, but also making sure that it works for people. Not, you know, the answer is we're not going to do that, not being an appropriate answer. We have undoubtedly work going on across all parts of the country on exactly the same challenges. One of the challenges that we have, and one of the reasons for variation across the country, is the level of risk averseness that individual local authorities and integration authorities have. And we're trying to support them with that to ensure that they know that they are empowered to be flexible. But I'll ask Joanne to answer.
Yeah, so in terms of work that for to do with the SDS improvement plan, there is a number of...
Would it maybe, for the sake of time, if you would write to the committee
on
that, okay. on that specific issue? Yeah,
that's fine. Sorry.
And Sandesh Gohani, 137.
Thank you. Minister, you spoke about Scottish Government vision earlier for self-directed support. What specific criteria did you have prior to Royal Assent in 2013 of the bill to judge its success?
Rachel, do you want to comment on that? What were their plans to measure in 2013 when it came forward, or were there plans in place when the legislation was introduced on metrics to measure to see if it had worked?
I would have to go back and have a look at some information on that. I'm afraid I haven't got that to hand at the moment. Any sort of
we can go back and look at it. I mean, that's long before I was elected and certainly long before I was in position here. So we'll go back and have a look at what was discussed around the time of the introduction in terms of metrics to measure to ensure that it was delivered appropriately. I suppose times have moved on somewhat since then, but I think you're absolutely right. It is important that we go and look at what the intention was at the time that it was introduced.
OK, so you're going to go back and look at that, and you're no doubt right to committee with that response. And in that response, it would be great to see what those metrics were and how you have achieved those metrics or not. What is your current specific criteria for success?
So in terms of... I mean, we want every individual in Scotland to be able to access social care. We want them to be able to access it in a way that is flexible, that meets their individual needs, and that enables them to flourish. We recognise from, and you know, this goes back to some of the challenges that we discussed with Tess White, it is challenging in terms of data to provide, for example, with the health system, we can look at things like the four-hour A&E metric, and that gives us an indication of the whole system. We haven't got simple metrics like that that are easy to measure, and that gives us an indication of the whole system health, which we can set targets for in social care. But we are keen...
Sorry, I wasn't asking for targets. I was asking what your criteria for success of this bill looks like.
Yeah.
So I think what goes back to the core principle of self-directed support, of that choice, the individuals having choice and control over how they receive their social care, which I think is why it's really positive that we've started drilling down into some of the data that we're getting through the Health and Care Experience Survey, because it's not just about working out who's receiving what options, but it's also about what was offered to them and how much involvement they felt around those decisions. So I think it does go to those core principles, and that's where the statutory duty does lie with local government, is about enabling that choice and control over how social care is delivered for people within local areas. And I think that is at the core of independent living and the principles of SDS that we go back to in how we're measuring success.
That is the principle. What's the specific criteria that you have used to judge this success a decade into the rollout of the bill?
So that would be my reference to the Health and Care Experience Survey and working with PHS to improve the data of it not just being about the delivery of those options, but also the people being asked, were you given the choice of those options? And people being aware that those options do exist and there is a choice over that. And that's one of the things that we're really keen to make sure we're measuring and we have better understanding how that is truly happening out there within local government.
And when do we expect to see results and data?
So some of that was captured in the Health and Care Experience Survey, which was published last month, as I said, which we've been trying to strengthen to capture that. And I think that's a really important survey for us to continue doing going forward to keep monitoring the position.
So you said some of that, but when will all of it?
Well, it addresses those questions around choice to help us better understand what is happening out there within local areas.
Right. OK. All right. I'm cognizant of time, so thank you very much.
Thank you. Can I thank the Minister and her officials for their evidence this morning? This is the final meeting of the committee ahead of the summer recess. Further details of our next meeting will be published towards the end of August, and that concludes the public part of our meeting today.